Today we celebrate this Holy Mass on the 22nd Sunday of Ordinary Time, this first Sunday of September, in loving memory of Stanley Grabowski, as offered by daughter, Patty Dotson. After Holy Mass, the love of God, Sodality will meet, along with our coffee hour taking place. This week we have our scheduled Masses and so on, and activities scheduled, including our workshop and including our trunk sale that is still tentatively taking place. We will follow up with any other news with that, you know, keeping an eye on weather, so on and so forth. And making special announcement of the Night of the Races. We are in Night of the Races month. We still have our tabs. If you're looking to grab those prizes to pass along, the event takes place. There's information in the bulletin. Please see Patty Dotson with any other questions regarding the Night of the Races. We're looking to sell tickets, and we also have some courses and everything that goes along with that. Now, we'll put those messages of selling everything aside. Our beginning of Mass this week is much quieter, much more even-keeled than last week. We have no bread to present. We have no bishop to honor his welcome. So we take a humble step back with this Holy Mass as we continue, though, the efforts that began last week with Prime Bishop's memorable homily from 5 feet in front of me. As he stood over you and much taller than I, and let you have it. So with that said, let us calm our hearts and minds as we celebrate this very interesting gospel and this very wonderful Mass this day. Using the second form of the Confiteor on the bottom of page 66, please recite with me. I confess to Almighty God, in the presence of the Blessed Virgin Mary, all the saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, that I have sinned through my own fault, in my thoughts, in my words, in what I have done or failed to do. I ask the Blessed Virgin Mary, all the saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. As many take a rest from the world this coming Monday, I ask that throughout the rest of the week that you take your time to seek out those yellow school buses, whether you're going by the kids at the bus stop before the bus gets there, or you see the buses going around town. You know, this city here is going back, I believe, at the end of this week. I should look at somebody who didn't know. Yeah, at the end of this week, some schools are in their second week and third week already, and I ask you to pray for the education, the peace, the safety of all of our kids, and again, let those yellow school buses be your call to prayer throughout this week. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. I, the Lord alone, probe the mind and test the heart to reward everyone according to the merit of his deeds.
My soul clings fast to you, your right hand upholds me.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Glory to God in the highest.
And peace
Father, you have put us on this earth to bear one another's burdens and to share in one another's joys. May we, who call ourselves Christian, so follow the way of your Son that we may die to sin and live for righteousness. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
According to Saint Matthew. began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer greatly from the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. Then Peter took Jesus aside and began to rebuke him. God forbid, Lord, no such thing shall ever happen to you. He turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are an obstacle to me. You are thinking not as God does, but as human beings do." Then Jesus said to his disciples, "Whoever wishes to come after me must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. What profit would there be for one to gain the whole world and forfeit his life? Or what can one give in exchange for his life? For the Son of Man will come with his angels in his Father's glory, and then he will repay all according to his conduct." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. O Lord, I am not worthy that thou should come to
of Matthew's gospel, just a few words that took place before the gospel today, that what is traditional theology, faith of the disciple that will forever be the bedrock of the church. Again, he preached it from 5 feet in front of you, with the authority of teaching that comes extra with the mitre-wearing, crozier-bearing bishop. That preaching ministry that he offered got my gears working overtime because I was thinking of what would I have said in that same gospel, and what should I say next week to sort of build upon that? I need to strongly follow up on the proclamation made by Christ: upon this rock I will build my church. Now I got to build that up. And I'm not so foolish to take something so wonderfully set up for me, like a golf ball on a golf tee, take something so wonderfully set up and fumble it away like a football player in the Cleveland Browns. You can keep your eyes on me in that regard, of course, but I am speaking not of any Brown or any golfer. I'm speaking of our Apostle Peter in today's gospel. But the events of the gospel they're real, aren't they? They're emblematic of real life stuff. How many times have any of us spent weeks, months, years building up a relationship, building up character, building up a job, only to have one slip-up ruin the whole thing? One mistake caused a negative reaction. We've all been there. Anybody who's married has been there as well. But here we are. After telling his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah, after telling his disciples that he was the Messiah, Jesus changes the vibe by telling them that he was going to be killed and raised, but no one heard past the word killed. Why would they? Such a strong display of why being a disciple could be so difficult. The closest followers of Jesus are now following a dead man. We are going to go to Jerusalem, and I'm going to be killed by elders, Pharisees, and scribes. Keep on following me. Jesus has yet to be wrong about anything with his followers. Peter believed him, and Peter believed the words that he said about his impending death. Peter and his fellow disciples believed him because they've already seen Jesus poke the proverbial bear. He's already gotten into snippets of arguments or more with Pharisees and with scribes and with Sadducees, people who have eyes and people who have ears to report these sorts of things. There are many others who did the same thing, who indeed ended up dead, who bore the name of a prophet. So Peter's message, the one who has the football right now, the one whose example of faith, the faith of the church, would be what the church was built upon, he told Jesus Christ two words: God forbid. Think about that one for a second. Think about how silly it is to say that to Jesus. The way we use that phrase nowadays, God forbid my son would have a bad first day of kindergarten last week, right? We say that same sort of thing. It's the same way that they used it millennia ago. But it was just moments earlier that the same Simon Peter declared Jesus Messiah, Son of the Living God. So while he was turning a phrase, he also said, God forbid, you are the Son of the Living God. God forbid. How can you acknowledge somebody as God and then say, God forbid, is what I'm getting at. And then it makes sort of sense when Jesus addresses him as Satan. This is the same type of thinking that Satan uses. Satan using Peter's lack of understanding to now tempt Jesus. Kind of like how Satan offered Jesus an entire kingdom without suffering, if only he knelt down and worshipped him. When Jesus tells Peter, get behind me, Satan, doesn't it sound close to what Jesus says on the first Sunday of Lent, away from me, Satan? After the temptation. In all of this, we see being a disciple is hard. 2,000 years later, or in real time. Now, we rewind a little further to the plight of Jeremiah. The second week in a row that we hear Jeremiah, and this time we hear from him from jail. He's in jail because of his prophecies, the insight of God given to him to pass to the people. God is speaking through Jeremiah truth, but guess what people don't like to hear? The truth. Especially when the truth isn't what they were hoping to hear. He is that proverbial shot messenger now put in jail because he told people that they had to change their ways or else they were going to be broken up. When we hear Jeremiah's lament, God, all I was doing was what you told me to do. Did you trick me? Why have I been chosen to proclaim a message that just makes people mad? And so on, I'm paraphrasing. Being a disciple is hard. Being a prophet is hard. And our mass dresses up that reality today. We're told that being a disciple involves renouncing all possessions. That being a disciple involves bearing on each other's burdens. That it also involves sharing each other's joy. Being mindful of God's demands in everything that we do, and being a disciple involves taking up your cross and following Jesus Christ. These are all things we hear in our Mass today. It's a phrase we know. It's popular. We remember that piece of scripture. There's always a cool graphic that involves with that. We look around at our stations of the cross, and indeed, we see the same sort of thing. take up your cross and follow me is something that makes sense to us Christians. But I must remind you how foreign this concept would have been to hear it in real time. Jesus didn't say, take up your guns. He didn't say, take up your swords. He didn't say, take up your armor. He said, take up your cross. This might have taken a few seconds to click with his disciples. It might not have clicked at all, let alone how long it would have taken to make any sort of sense. The cross meant execution. And the condemned would have to carry either the whole thing or usually just that horizontal cross beam. That vertical beam might already be in the ground, still heavy, still enough to bear the weight of a human being. There's no honor in that. There's no glory in carrying a portion of your instrument of execution. We know that this is part of the psychological torture that made crucifixion so bad. Not only will you die, you have to carry that implement. And we know that the apostles of Jesus will fail at taking up that cross and following him. There's a station on that wall over there that says they had to pull a bystander from the crowd, Simon of Cyrene, in order to help Jesus take up that cross and lead him and follow him. It will take, as also foretold and forgotten immediately, resurrection and gifts of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost that will set them on a ministry that is worthy of Christ. Being a disciple is hard. And part of taking up the cross of Christ, of losing one's life, is saving it. Eternal life was something that was worth dying for. That's not just Christian theology. That was popular theology in Judaism at the time of Christ walking the earth as well. People came to the belief, portions of the Jewish faith, that yes, if eternal life was there, it was worth dying for. Centered around the idea of what the Jewish Messiah would be. But it was imagined to be in perhaps the throes of war against Israel's enemies. Of course it's worth to die in the glory of war following that Messiah that would lead us against our enemies. But not following this peaceful sort of prophet who would soon explain that laying down his life for the sheep was how to grant them eternal life. Not following a peaceful Messiah that said, we have to go to Jerusalem where I know I'm going to die, by people who can't carry their own weapons. While Peter acknowledged Jesus as Messiah, these events also turned out and showed what the Messiah was going to be for his people. And he and his fellow followers had a lot to learn about the cost of discipleship. While we take a break next week to celebrate the solemnity of brotherly love and, well, the good parts of discipleship that they are, the love that we share, that we're told we have to share each other's joys today as part of being a disciple as well, we will continue to see the disciples and us peer further in to see what it is to be a disciple following our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to and with the cross. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. us offer our prayers this morning that all who follow Jesus may do so with hearts full of hope and love.
For our brother, Stanley Dobrovolsky, as we offer this holy mass in his loving memory this day, we pray to the Lord. For the increase of courage in discipleship and an increase of strength in the ability to take up the cross, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may be ready to support those who suffer loss from natural disasters throughout hurricane season and beyond, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the ability to discern when evil is crossing our paths of life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the healing of leaders in government and industry who use greed and power to dominate, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Hebrews chapter 4 tells us that anyone who enters God's rest also rests from his own work. That we may seek moments of a godly peace on this Labor Day 2023. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For God's healing graces to continue to pour out on all we know and love, especially Richard and Edna Samuelson, Shannon Alberino, Eugene Fagan, Jack Spilka, Kim Penny, Johanna Markowitz, Michelle Ostrowski, Kathy Robertson, Lou and Margaret Hefner, Sue Ann Penny, George Seifel, Penny Dennison, Joe Orlowski, Jay Jersey, Shauna Smolin, Deb Wilson, June Zahn. For all on our parish's prayer list, for all friends and family members, for parishioners of our parish, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the souls of the faithful departed, especially Stanley Dobrovolsky, for all departed friends and family members in our parish, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, receive the prayers of your people seeking to discover your will by striving in the footsteps of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
In the same way, every one of you who does not renounce all his possessions cannot be my disciple.
Praise God from all.
Blessed are you, Lord God, all creation.
You
call us to bear our cross. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
My blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which shall be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Celebrate the memorial of our redemption, recalling Christ's death and descent among the dead, proclaiming his resurrection and ascension to your right hand, awaiting his coming in glory, and offering to you from the gift you have given us, this bread and this cup. We praise you and bless you.
We praise you, we bless you, we give thanks to you, and we pray to you, Lord.
We pray that in your goodness and mercy, your Holy Spirit may descend upon us and upon these gifts, sanctifying them and showing them to be holy gifts for your holy people, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant that all who share this bread and this cup may become one body and one spirit, a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your name. Remember your one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church redeemed by the blood of your Christ. Reveal its unity, guard its faith, and preserve it in peace. Remember Anthony, our Prime Bishop, and all who minister in your church. Remember all your people and those who seek your truth, especially those who we raise in intercession this day, for those who we raise in the quietness of our own hearts. Remember all who have died in the peace of Christ, whose faith is known to you alone, especially as we recall the memory of our brother, Stanley Dobrovolsky. Remember the place of eternal joy and light, and grant that we may find our inheritance with the Blessed Virgin Mary, with our ancestors in faith, with the prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and all the saints who have found favor with you in ages past. We praise you in union with them and give you glory through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Through Christ and with his Christ and in Christ, all honor and glory are yours, Creator above all, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever.
Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Do not look at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, where you live forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
May we take this time to offer each other a sign of our Lord and Savior's peace. I will take the bread of heaven and call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of Christ bring me to everlasting life. Blood of Christ, bring me to everlasting life. carry his own cross and come after me. Let us pray. Almighty God, by the power of this Holy Communion, may we willingly take up our cross and follow Christ, and therefore find both peace and glory. We pass this to the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever.